Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Let us pray. Merciful and everlasting God, we commend to your care and keeping these friends who mourn the passing of their loved one. May they be upheld by your love and presence, and find in you an ever-present help in time of trouble. Grant them grace to say with a believing heart, "Your will be done," and to know that your will is a good and gracious will, even now. Comfort them through your gospel, which promises strength and help to the troubled and weary. O Lord, be with them in this hour, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I invite Betty Brusky up, Brusky up for scripture reading.
I am actually using my mom's devotional Bible, and I would like to point out that one of her markers is a Dove chocolate wrapper. So, from Proverbs 31, chapters 10 through 31. A wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She is like the merchant ships bringing food from afar. She gets up while it is still dark and provides food for her family and portions for her servant girls. She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her task. She sees that her trading is profitable, and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the reward she has earned, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate. And from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What does the worker gain from his toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on men. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the hearts of men. Yet they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for men than to be happy and do good while they live. that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all his toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it so that man will rever him. Whatever is already been and what will be has been before, and God will call the past to account.
Now invite the grandchildren forward to sing a song, and they'll be followed by several family members sharing memories.
We can only imagine what heaven's going to be like, and we can only imagine what Grandma's doing up there right now. We all know that she's probably dancing with Grandpa, giving loves to Carly, little Liam, and her parents.
What it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or not if you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? When all of you be still, will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When all I will do is forever worship. worship you. I can only imagine.
Now we invite Robert Klug to share some memories.
Well, good afternoon. If I get rambling, it's because I don't write up anything what I'm going to say. I'm just going to take it from memory. When Cindy called me and asked if I'd share some memories of Marilyn, I said I would. And as usual, I don't prepare myself. So this morning at 3 o'clock, when Lucky, my cat, woke me up for his early morning feeding, which he gets every morning, I thought, I better get something together. And then I got thinking, how am I going to talk about Marilyn without including Wally, not walleye, I'm thinking fishing. So I did some thinking, and then I thought, I have to tell you, I get to use my brand new Bible today. I said, how lucky can a husband be when his wife buys him a Bible to use? I mean, that's the best gift you can get. And my old one was, the pages were falling out, so. I'm going to read from Mark 10, 6 through 9. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not men separate. And if there was two people that I know that were joined as one, it had to be Marilyn and Wally. I never seen them, but what they were always together. And when I really got to know Marilyn well was when I was working for the city, and she became our city clerk. And I tell you, what she put up with and never complained, I can't imagine, because she started in the old city hall, which was falling down around her, and when we finally decided it had to be tore down, we moved her office into the ambulance garage, which was attached to the maintenance garage. And if you can imagine working in the winter time, when it's 30 below and the wind's blowing, and you're sitting in a garage with three overhead doors that go up and down as the ambulances are leaving. The maintenance garage had an opening to it, diesel motor starting up and the smoke drifting in. And not once did Marilyn ever complain. She might say, Bob, isn't there some way you can maybe get it a little warmer in here? And I said, well, Marilyn, if you quit opening all the doors, it wouldn't get so cold. But I think it was about 10 years that she worked for the city clerk. And I think it was in 1987, Marilyn and I decided that we had worked hard enough for the city and it was time to take a vacation. And we decided we might even take Wally and Marge along with us. So we took a trip on Amtrak, and I still relive those days that the four of us were together. We left out of Grand Forks and rode the train to Seattle, Washington, and from there we took a ferry to, I can't even think of the island now, but we spent the night there and in the Rose Gardens and stuff, and then jumped on the train again and went to San Francisco, where Wally's sister lived, and we spent 3 days with her. And the one thing I can remember being at Wally's sister's place was she had a lemon tree in the backyard, and I'm not kidding, those lemons had to be that big around hanging on there, and what a joy it was to visit with her. And then we still had a couple dollars left in our pockets, so our next stop was at Reno, and when we left Reno, we didn't have a couple dollars left in our pocket. And in order to get back to home, you had to go to Chicago and stay overnight in Chicago and then get on the train and come back home. Well, we stayed at this motel in a suburb out, and we were calling a cab to take us to Union Station. And a guy seen us there, and he said, is there some place you guys are going? And we said, yeah, we're trying to get back to Union Station to catch the train. And he said, well, I have a limousine here, and I'm waiting for some golfers, and they won't be here till the afternoon. So is it all right if I charge you the same thing the cab would cost you? I'll take you and tour the city and then get you to the depot in time to catch your train. And we said, well, sure. And then as Wally started visiting with the guy, well, he found out he was a retired truck driver. And if you can imagine two retired truck drivers driving us around Chicago, yeah. Well, Marilyn, Marge, and I were enjoying the scenery. Those two were reliving all their truck driving experiences. And I guess I'll just never forget that. It was a trip of a lifetime. Well, then, after Marilyn retired and stuff, we still stayed good friends and stuff with him. And then the next big thing in our lives together was when Faith Lutheran became, and we were all chartered members, and Faith and Marilyn was such a worker for the church, and Wally too, and there's just so many memories of what went on. But the one that really sticks in my mind is when we built the church, we made a mistake how we put the sheetrock on this back wall here, and there was a crack that kept showing up. And if I'm right, I think it was Dennis that kept trying to repair it. And about a little later, there the crack would be again. Well, Marilyn figured out that there's no way Dennis was ever going to get it fixed. So she made those wall hangings that are on both sides of the wall there. And she was looking out for you, Dennis. And as we grow older, and after Wally passed away, then Marilyn moved into the assisted living, and my brother Ray was also in assisted living. And the big thing was the two of them getting to church. So every Saturday evening about the same time, the phone would ring. Marge would say, I bet it's Marilyn. And I said, I told her I'd pick her up on Sunday. Yeah, but she'll be checking. So I'd answer, hi, Marilyn. Bob, are we going to church in the morning? I'd say, yes. What time? Same time, 8:30. And we'd stop and pick her up. And we did that till Marilyn just wasn't able to go anymore, and I sure miss that, because just that driving through town, and she always share memories of growing up in Blackduck, And that was the one thing both of us had in common. We both grew up in Blackduck and made it our home for our whole life. And I hope the Page kids know how fortunate they were to have Marilyn and Wally. What a good Christian family, and to be brought up knowing that Jesus is their Lord. And I guess I'd just like to close with reading Matthew 25:21. His Lord said to her, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." I know without a doubt that Marilyn right now is with the joy of her Lord.
And now there's several granddaughters who are going to share memories.
This is a memory from Gary Page, a celebration of life. What an appropriate expression in this case. 98 years for a woman who loved life, loved her family and the people around her, and always looked on the bright side, no matter how hard things got. Mom lived through World War II with a brother in the Navy submarine service and her husband on a troop transport in the Pacific. And she had two little boys to look after. After the war, when few jobs were available, Dad had to work foreign construction in Greenland to put biscuits on the table, and Mom kept the family together for 18 months at a time. If she ever cried or worried, she never let her grandchildren know about it. The only time I saw her get shook up was when a team of horses spooked and rolled a load of oats on top of Dad, and the crew had to dig him out. While I was in Vietnam, I could always count on letters from Mom. I still have many of them. Mom and Dad fell in love when they were in the 10th grade and stayed that way until Dad died about 8 years ago. This one is from Brandon Page. I have many great memories of Grandma Marilyn. I always enjoyed the Christmas and Thanksgiving parties we had at Grandma and Grandpa's house in Hines. At 98 years, I cannot imagine the amount of change she has experienced over the years, from horse-drawn equipment and Model T cars being common to the internet and cell phones. She will be greatly missed. Thank you to my Uncle Dennis and Aunt Carol Lossing Page for everything you have done and for hosting and arranging so many events over the years. This one is from Dennis Page. I remember when Mom went down to David and Esther's on New Year's Eve. She parked the 53 Chevy car in the driveway on top of the hill. She went into the house and she came out. The car was at the bottom of the hill wrapped around the light pole. She had forgotten to put the brake on. After that, we had always gave her a hard time about her New Year's Eve car crash. Sorry. Just
I remember when the Luther League was Christmas caroling and Reynold Gustafson was ahead of me in their family's 57 Chevy, and I was on Mother's 55 Oldsmobile following him. He pulled into Austin's driveway, where Dan and Judy Barra now live, and I couldn't stop. I ran into him. Then I knew I had to tell Mother, so I went home, and she was in bed sleeping. I knocked on the bedroom door, and I said, "Mom, you always wanted one of those compact cars. Now you have one." She just said, "Did anybody get hurt?" This one's from a memory from Carol Page. When I married Dennis 54 years ago, my mother was gone and Marilyn had been my mom for all these years. I didn't have much money, so she made my wedding dress. We have always lived just down the road from them in Hines, so we had many Sunday roast beef dinners at Mom and Dad's. I remember all the great family gatherings at Christmas and all the tins of baked goods, which included fruit cake and fruit soup. I have had the privilege of doing Mom's hair every week for many years. She loved all those grandkids, great-grandkids, and great-great-grandkids. Miles loved to go on nursing home. Miles loved to go to the nursing home to visit Grandpa. All right, we'll see if I can do this. Miles loved to go to the nursing home to visit Grandma from the time he was little. We will miss you, Mom and Grandma, but we know you are in a better place with your loved ones who went before you. All right, this is a memory from Twyla Page Whitwer. Grandma, my angel, being the firstborn grandchild, I got to be spoiled first. I remember spending lots of time with Grandma. We only lived down the road, so it was easy to call her when we needed her, and she never said no. Grandma was the one I always asked for when I got a bad owie, because Mom always would faint. Many Sundays were spent at Grandma and Grandpa's after church with a mashed potato and roast beef meal. It was always delicious. Grandma helped Dad take care of Dean and me when Mom went and finished cosmetology school. Grandma was always my ride home after my piano lessons. Her office was convenient to walk to, and I remember doing lots of homework and waiting for her to get done with work. Grandma always hosted large family Christmas and Thanksgiving gatherings at their home and continued doing so until she moved into the townhomes in Blackduck. For many years, I was Grandma's cleaning help. I was hired to help keep her home clean and tidy. These were treasured times for me with Grandma, as I got to help with duties that got harder for her to keep up with and gave us time to have special lunch dates at different restaurants. We always had our lunch dates scheduled into my cleaning days. Every day, moment, and year with Grandma is treasured. I'm so thankful we had so many with her. We were truly blessed to have her. What a special Grandma. I know she's dancing up in heaven with Grandpa and giving lots of love to Carly and little Liam. What a joy to know we will see Grandma again. This is a memory from Aubrey Whitwer Hendricks. I have a couple different favorite memories of great Grandma. The first one was when I was in fifth grade. I had to do a heritage project and decided to interview great Grandma for the essay portion. I loved getting to know about great Grandma's childhood, but my favorite part was how much she enjoyed telling us all of her stories and telling us differences between her childhood and mine. My other favorite was my other favorite was when she came to my last recital for voice lessons. I had a few opera pieces, and when I got done with them, she told me how much she enjoyed it, and it made me feel like a professional. She was always so sweet and supportive when she came to my shows. She truly was a great grandma. This one is from Cindy Klug. When I think about Mom, I remember how organized she was. I remember coming home a day ahead of the holiday and she already had everything done. So patient. When Gary and Den were both teasing me, she couldn't help but laughing. One time Dennis went and got the mail and opened a letter from my boyfriend. He took the letter and went into the bathroom and locked the door and read it out loud, adding to it. I was pounding on the door and screaming so no one could hear what he was saying. Mother just laughed. All right, this is Becky Brusky. I remember Gary and Den sitting mom on the kitchen counter and tickling her until she wet her pants. And there was the time they shut her and Todd and me in the basement and held the door shut. Again, she laughed so hard. Mom always made us or encouraged us to do all the school or summer rec activities, which meant I tried more things than I would have on my own. When Mark and I were going to get married, we were just going to go to the Justice of the Peace, but Mom put her foot down and arranged the reception. The church ladies in the aisle were talking about all the wonderful bars that were served for several years. Brianna Brusky. I remember Grandma in her kitchen cooking and great breakfast on three-season porch. All right, and this is Renee Eichstead. I remember how much fun it was to watch Mom and Dad dance together at wedding dances. Mom also loved to polka. Again, much laughter was involved. Mom was always there when we needed her. She always gave me much good advice. I just didn't always realize it at that time. She told us, if you don't have anything good to say about someone, then don't say anything. Stephen Eichstead. I don't remember her ever saying anything negative about anyone ever. Michael Eichstead. Whenever she and Grandma talked, they would say to each other, I love you and I miss you. Mom and Grandma, we love you and we miss you. All right, this is Dean Page. Grandma set the standards pretty high for any grandparents. Not intentionally, she was just the sweetest and most wonderful person anybody would ever meet. Grandma could not say no to anyone, which makes you wonder how any of her children ever turned out. Every Sunday, Grandma would make dinner a lot of the times. It would be a roast. She knew I liked it a little crispy, so of course she gave me the crispy end. And her mashed potatoes were made perfect with some lumps in them. Yes, Jonathan, I said lumps. Jonathan, on the other hand, did not like lumps. I spent a lot of my younger years at Grandma and Grandpa's. Mom was in beauty school and Dad had to work a lot. I will never forget the time there was a storm and lightning hit. I was standing on the heat register upstairs and the lightning hit and I blew me off the heat register. And I screamed Grandma and she came running up the stairs. She hugged me and said, you're going to be just fine. One of the latest high school memories with Grandma was the school bus ride, Cadillac style. Grandma would pick me up every morning in the Cadillac and I thought I was the coolest kid on the block. There were many mornings we were running late, but I did not want to ride the school bus. Grandma lived a great life and we will miss her like crazy, but we know she is in a better place and we may be a little sad here, but Grandpa is smiling and very glad to have his bride.
What a household. Funny, it's lots of memories. Not only did she cover for me on my sheetrock problems, but I think when Mother passed, I lost 75% of my fan club. She used to think I could sing pretty good. Of course, that's a mother, you know. But anyhow, when we were called, like 1:30 in the morning to go, and because Mother was having a tough time, well, it was great that we could be there. Carol and I got up and got dressed 1:30 in the morning, went there, and she was very responsive. I mean, we could ask her questions, are you warm, are you cold, are you hungry, and she would answer yes, no, and she'd tell us where she hurt and everything, but it was great to be there with her, and Carol asked her if she wanted to read to her, so she read the 23rd Psalm to Grandma, and I sang a song to her, and that's a song I'm going to sing to you now. She thought I could sing good, so. And devotions the other day, I come across this at Revelations 21:4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. And that's kind of what this song is saying the same thing as, what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky, and no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, a glorious day that will be. What a day that will be, when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, a glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, and no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. Oh, what a day, a glorious day that will be. What a day that will be, when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, a glorious day that will be. What a day, a glorious day that will be.
Right. And did the granddaughters have another song?
Story I'd have to tell the principals, or what words I might say. We were running kind of late, and I was getting kind of scared. The grandma held my hand and said, "Dean, everything is gonna be okay." The grandma couldn't see him, oh, but he was standing there. I knew in my heart she was the answer to my prayers. Oh,
I believe in angels in my heart, sent down to us from somewhere up above. We come to you and me in our darkest hours. Show us how to live, teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love.
When life held troubled times, and had me down on my knees, there's always been someone to come along and comfort me. A kind word from a stranger to lend a helping hand. A phone call from a friend just to say I understand. And ain't it kind of funny, at the dark end of the road, someone lights the way with just a single ray of hope. Somewhere up above, they come to you and me. In our darkest hours, to show us how to live, to teach us how to feel, to guide us with the light of love. There were so many faces show up in the strangest places, grace us with their mercies in our time of need. Oh,
I believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me darkest hours, to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love,
to guide us with the light of
Marilyn Mae, Langord Page, 98, passed away peacefully at the Good Samaritan Society in Blackduck at 6:20 a.m. on November 19, 2022. She was born on August 11, 1924 to her parents, Henry and Jenny Langord. Marilyn grew up in Blackduck, Minnesota, and graduated from Blackduck High in 1942. She and her husband, Wallace G. Page, were married on September 22, 1942. They moved to the Page Farm in Hines, Minnesota, where they raised six children. Marilyn was an active member at First Lutheran Church in Hines. She was the first woman to serve on the church council there. Years later, she and Wallace were founding members of Faith Lutheran Church in Black Duck. Marilyn was a member of the Hines Hoe and Hope Garden Club, the Red Hat Society, the Daughters of the American Revolution, and the American Legion Auxiliary Unit number 372. Marilyn was proud of her pioneer heritage. She was very active in the preservation of the history of the Black Duck and Pines areas. She spent many hours working on the Hines History Book Committee and volunteering at the Black Duck History Center. She loved to play Scrabble, do crossword and jigsaw puzzles, and made many beautiful quilts. Marilyn worked at several part-time jobs while raising their children. She also was the bookkeeper for Greg and Page and for Page Trucking Company. Once their children had all graduated from high school, she took a job as the city clerk in Black Duck, where she worked until retirement in 1989. For many years, Marilyn was the homemaker, while Wallace was first in the Navy, then working in Greenland, and then as an over-the-road trucker. She was always there for her husband, children, parents, and mother-in-law. She did it all with a smile and laughter. She made it a fun household. Marilyn is survived by her six children, Gary Page and wife Sherry, Dennis Page and wife Carol, Cynthia Klug and husband John, Renee Eichstead and husband Stephen, Rebecca Brusky and husband Mark, and Wallace Todd Page and wife Deborah. 10 grandchildren, Twyla Whitwer, Dean Page, Colonel Jonathan Klug, Brandon Page, Michael Eichstead, Brianna Brusky, Alexis Breidenbach, Allison Page, Nicholas Klug, and Evan Page. 13 great-grandchildren, 3 great-great-grandchildren, her brother Glenn Langord, sister-in-law Nancy Langord, and many nieces and nephews. She was preceded in death by her husband Wallace G. Page, granddaughter Carly Brusky, great-great-grandson Liam Spencer, parents Henry and Jenny Langord, brother Harold Langord, and sister-in-law Betty Langord. May the Lord bless her memory. Let's turn in the hymnal to number 495. It is well with my soul.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul. It is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the joy of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sighed. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump and the Lord shall descend, even so. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul, with my soul. It is well with my soul.
us your comfort, to bring us the hope that we have in Christ. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we grieve the loss of Marilyn to this life, many of us experience different reactions. Common to this experience are issues addressed in Romans 8, such as frustration, groaning, and even, though on the other end, anticipation. So let us read from Romans chapter 8, verses 18 through 25. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now, hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Heavenly Father, these are your words. Thy word is eternal truth. Sanctify us today in thy truth, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. As we consider the groanings of this life, we experience that when we have a loss. We are seeing here, as it mentions, several reactions that we can have to the troubles and the trials that this life brings our way. It speaks of the sufferings of this present time. And yes, we suffer. But it also notes then that those sufferings are not comparable with the glory that is to be revealed. And we know that the glory of God, what's glory? Glory is that awesomeness that attracts our attention to something that's excellent, isn't it? Glory is that which rises above the crowd to exemplify that which we should be attracted to, that which we should pay attention to, that which should draw us to emulate and imitate it. And so we see the glory is yet to be revealed. We see great and glorious things in this life. We heard many memories celebrating the good things that Marilyn has done. And yet we know what God has done is that much greater. It's that much better. It's that much more worthy of glory, of turning our attention to it and praising the work of our Savior, Jesus Christ, in saving us. So we read here that the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. That as we go through this life, that Jesus said that they will know you are my disciples when you have love one for another. And to recognize, why should that be such a big deal, to love one another? Well, as I've thought of that over the years, I think of two things. One is that the kind of love is mentioned is God's love. It's agape love. It's a selfless love. And we don't, in our normal lives, love selflessly. We're much more prone to, I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine. And we want to give favor to those that give us favor. We want to make those feel good who make us feel good. And God's love for us says when we were yet sinners,
Christ died for the ungodly, the ones who were rebelling against him, the ones who didn't want his presence in their lives. That's the kind that God loved. And that's the kind of love that will show people that we are disciples of Christ. And that's the kind of love we look for in the glory of God to be revealed. A love that overcomes all the challenges, all the hurts, all the sorrows and suffering of this life. And so we see that, but for now, it has been subjected to futility. Or another translation says it's been subjected to frustration. If you've ever tried to do something and just couldn't get it to work, you're assembling the toy, but slot A doesn't fit tab B, or however it's supposed to go together. We know frustration. And we know, even Paul said, the good that I would do, I do not, and the evil I hate is what I do. And we're frustrated in this life. It says the whole of creation is subject to this futility, this frustration, and we want to overcome it. But we struggle in this life. We struggle in this life in part because this life is not meant to last forever. This time that we're given on earth is to prepare us for eternity. There's where we find our heavenly home. This world, if we belong to Jesus, if we're citizens of heaven, is not our home. This world is a traveling through place, a stop along the way, a motel or a wayside rest or a campground. But we so often want it to be permanent. We have trouble imagining how it can be better. We struggle with the knowing that we have to continue in this life when others have gone on and left this life. And so the Bible says this is a bondage to decay. The world is always falling apart because it's not going to last forever. It's been corrupted. It's destined for destruction. But we know that we wait for the hope of the revealing of the sons of God, the revealing of the glory that is yet to be revealed in heaven. But we're still frustrated in this life because we live in a fallen and broken world. When God created the heavens and the earth and all that is in it, he pronounced it very good. But then Adam and Eve sinned, and all that goodness was made bad. It was corrupted. It was contaminated. And it's not as good as when it was made. We still see many vestiges of that goodness. We still see the greatness of God in the beauty of nature. We see the greatness of God in the love that a grandmother has for grandchildren. We see the greatness of God in so many things. But it's an imperfect view. Paul says that for now we see through a glass dimly, but then we shall see face to face. And so we get frustrated because we can't see it clearly. We live in a fallen, broken world. We struggle in this life, and we're frustrated that we don't get more time. Or we look back and we're frustrated because we haven't used the time that we've had as well as we could have. And we haven't done that which might have been done. But yet, that's God's plan. So that we are not stuck in this fallen and broken and sinful world forever. But we have a hope of a better life to come. This is not all there is. But at the same time, as we're frustrated, it speaks of our groaning, the moaning, the, oh, wow. Oh, no, that we often utter when there's a hard task, when something is too heavy, when something just hits us too hard. And we say at a time like this, we groan and moan and grieve. Some say not to cry. I've heard people say they didn't want people crying at their funeral. And I think, well, if nobody wants to cry at my funeral because I'm gone, what kind of life have I lived? Because I don't take any joy in causing them sadness. But I do take joy in causing them joy that brings them sadness when I'm no longer bringing them joy. And I think that's what we have here today too. We have a sadness, but it's a sadness because of joy. It's a sadness because of fond memories. It's a sadness because of good experiences and good times. And we know that's changing. And so the world groans. And we want to say that, you know, when people miss us, you know, I want them to miss me. And if Marilyn is departed from this life to the next, it leaves a hole in our lives. And we cannot deny this. And yet, with the frustration, with the futility, with the groaning, it says we have an anticipation. We have a hope. We await our redemption as sons, the adoption, and in this hope, we are saved. And so we see the anticipation mixed in with the sorrow and frustration is a joy. You know, Marilyn's suffering and sorrow in this life is over. The Bible tells us we do not grieve as those who have no hope. But in Christ we find our hope. We cannot be hoping that we're good enough to be accepted by Him. But that's the promise of God, is that we cannot be good enough. But He has made the way. God sent His only Son into the world to die for our sins so that whoever believes in Him would have eternal life. And so our hope of eternity is not based on, have I made enough cookies for the grandchildren? Have I been nice enough to my co-workers? Have I been kind to those people around me? No, that comes from our knowing God. But our hope of eternity, our hope of adoption as children of God, is based on what God has already done. For God so loved the world, He gave His one and only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but have eternal life. And so we see, even earlier in this book of Romans, in chapter 3, in verse 23, it tells us all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Even Marilyn, she has no hope in her good works. She has no hope in her kindnesses. But we have hope in Jesus Christ. And so as we continue to walk in this world without her, we continue to walk in this world with Jesus, with His call to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then all these other things we worry about can be added unto us. The good news is that though we have fallen short of the glory of God, that God has provided us a Savior, His only Son, Jesus Christ. So we are reminded during times like this of our own mortality, how we fall short of the ideal. In seeing that, let us turn to the God of the Bible and to His Son Jesus, who promises to forgive us if we will turn from our sins and believe in Him and receive His forgiveness. May we also draw upon the only one who can give the strength to rightly demonstrate those traits rightly in our lives, the hope, the faith, and the love. And those come to us from Jesus Christ. He's the one that gives us the strength to hope. He's the one that gives us the strength to believe. He's the one that gives us the strength to love. And in those, we have, in Him, we find our hope. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we again thank You, Lord, for Your promises, for Your work, for the gifts You have given, the blessings that You have brought our way. And Lord, though in this world the blessings we see are all fallen and broken, and yet, Lord, we know that the blessings You have for us in eternity are so much better, so much grander, so much more pure and lovely. And so, Lord, continue to grant us the strength to be patient and live this life in anticipation of that. Give us the faith to believe in Jesus, that his blood can cover all our sins and make a way for us. Lord, give us the strength to love our neighbor as ourself, as you have called us to do. May we do this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Same word, precious Lord, take my hand, number 611.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call. Hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
Let us pray. Almighty everlasting God, because of our sin, we must die and return to the ground. So teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Grant us a true faith in your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, who was delivered for our offenses, was raised again for our justification, and reigns to all eternity. Help us by your grace that we may die daily unto sin and live according to your holy will, so that when the hour of death shall come, we may be prepared through faith in your word for a peaceful departure. Receive our souls unto yourself, and grant that at the last day our bodies may rise again from the grave unto everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Well, family, again, thank you for coming today. You're all invited to stay for the lunch afterwards here in the reception hall. The burial will be taking place at a later date, so we won't have the burial today. Are there any other announcements at the close of the service here? And we'll prepare to process out by hearing the benediction. Now the peace of God, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, may he equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Go in God's grace.